Looks like it's live.
All right. Well, welcome everybody. Thank you for so much for joining us tonight. I'm Jen Wolf, and I want to first of all thank right off the bat thank the Johnson County ADA Planning Committee and sponsors for giving this group. Whether we go by Upgrade Medicaid or Iowa Disability League as we're transitioning, the $500 award to help us facilitate and make these events. So thank you so much for joining us. This is the first in our third or up three events that we're having all about getting out the disability vote in Iowa. And we're very excited to have you here because this is, it's probably never been more important, but what we're finding when trying to get things changed for people with disabilities and our caregivers and our families, it just seems like we've been stuck. And one way that we can fight that is by getting out the vote. So we're here tonight to just kind of introduce kind of the logistics and learn from the disability community themselves on what's worked and what hasn't, different resources. But yeah, I want to give everybody a chance to introduce themselves because we've got an awesome group of folks tonight. Again, I'm Jen Wolf. I'm a disabled occupational therapist and organizer. I am a white female wearing dark frame glasses, purple tint to my hair in my workroom slash bedroom. And I am going to pass it to Kyle and Bill.
Thanks, Jen. I'm Bill.
Kyle.
And Kyle has some limited speech capabilities. So if I talk too much, it's because I kind of speak for both. But Kyle will interject as he can. So both of our personal pronouns are he, him, and his. We are sitting in our living room with white curtains behind us and brown walls. And what color hair do you have? Kyle has reddish brown hair. As he gets older, it gets more brown. As I get more older, my hair gets more white, which is the color of my hair now. So we're going to, do you want to stand up? We're both wearing white t-shirts with an envelope on the front that says, "This is what democracy looks like." Hence, mail-in absentee ballots. So we're going to talk a little bit about that today. I think this is your fourth presidential election you'll be voting in. And we aren't going to go to the polls this year, are we? What? How are we going to vote?
So
we're going to vote by mail, aren't we? We did that in the primary this year for reasons. Yes?
Can we have everybody introduce themselves before you go into?
Oh, you want to do the all the, okay, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Okay.
We're formal, we're all good.
See, I jumped in too quick again.
just passion, excitement.
I'm sorry.
Eric.
Okay, I'm Eric Dunot. I'm a disability activist. I'm known as Mr. Everywhere because I'm involved in everything. So I am a 40-year-old man in my wheelchair. I'm sitting in my wheelchair in my living room. That's where I use my Zoom capabilities. And my apartment in my living room has white walls with a window to the window with white blinds to the back of me. And I'll be doing the presentation on how to have a voting experience in person. Thank you.
Garrett, on to you.
Hello, I'm Garrett Fry from Cedar Rapids. I go by he, him, his, and we. I have brown hair. Brown eyes. I am tan skin. I have a blue t-shirt on right now. that celebrates the 30th anniversary of the ADA. I'm currently in my bedroom, which is where I also have my computer and everything set up, and I will be presenting on disability rights and how voting rights for individuals with disabilities.
Miss Cindy.
Hi, I'm Cindy Raymer. I have mostly white hair. I wear glasses that have a tint of purple to them. And I go by she, her, hers, for my pronouns. And I am actually in my kitchen, which is where I have my laptop set up. And I will be talking about family, friends, and caregivers voting.
And we also have to give a special thank and welcome to our interpreters. Holly is live now, and Lisa will be joining us in a bit. Real quick before we let these wonderful people talk, registration. Of course, that's kind of the first step. I jumped ahead of myself too. Look at that. One of the biggest stats is we have 365,000 people with disabilities that identify with disabilities in Iowa. And generally we vote at approximately 10% less than the general population. If we could get that 10% to get out and vote, even that much could sway elections. So there's power in that disability vote and community vote that has been untapped. And many people have spoken about this. Tucker Cassidy has talked about this. Eric has talked about this. Garrett has talked about this. Rima McCoy McDeed has talked about this. And Gretchen Brown-Walk has talked about this. So it's a very timely issue. For registration, and as soon as I pass it over to Kyle and Bill, I will post a link to find out if you are registered, and then also how to register if you are not. That's all I've got. It's on to Bill and Kyle, and we'll give a short break so Lisa can pop in.
Okay, we good? All right. So again, well, you know who we are now. And I think my new theme song is going to be Oops, I Did It Again, because I do this every time and jump in and I just start rambling, don't I? Kyle sometimes lets me know when I'm talking too much, but I don't usually listen, do I? But so anyway, Kyle, I mentioned this will be, I believe, his fourth presidential election. And I'm, really proud of him for that, because I, as a young adult, didn't start voting right away. I think probably two presidential elections went by before I even voted. So I was a late starter, but Kyle started right away and he's been very engaged in the process. So, and again, I probably helped him along making that decision, because as Jen was saying, it's so important for the disability population to vote. And it truly is an untapped voting block. But I think things like this, events like this, and all the amazing people that Jen mentioned, their voices out there are helping to make a difference. And I'm seeing the conversation turn in not only in Iowa, but in the country, and starting to look at some disability issues. So we have a strong voice and need to use it, right? And Kyle certainly has done that in the primary process last year. So So we usually vote in person, don't we? We love to go to the polls. It's a big deal for us. Get little stickers, right? And Kyle has the last couple times voted in person, we use the touch screens. And I can't emphasize that enough for folks that think that that might be useful to them. I found it helpful for me as well. Anybody can actually use those. If they're not set up, they should be set up. And if you feel like you want to use them and they don't have them set up, they need to. And that is part of the law, I believe. So we find them user-friendly, but this year, because of COVID, we have decided to vote by mail, or absentee, we should say. We voted by mail in the primary in June, didn't we? Filled out our ballots. Put them in the mail then. This time around, we have requested our absentee ballot, and we are going to drop them off at the courthouse. But however you do that, make sure that you've sent in your absentee ballot request if you're planning on voting absentee, and do that early so you can get your ballot early. Because if you do use the mail, I encourage folks, regardless of the rumors about the Postal Service, I encourage people to mail them in early to make sure that they arrive in time at the auditor's office. And also encourage people, if you have any questions about anything that I say, call your auditor's office, because they'll give you the accurate information. And I know Eric's going to give you some really awesome information when he talks about that process. So he'll have a lot on that. Our courthouse has a drop box. I'm not sure if every courthouse does. We have two. And we're going to, as soon as we get those ballots, we'll probably fill them out that day and drop them off that day, just to make sure they're in there, and then track our ballot as well. And that's something that's really kind of cool that you're able to do, track your ballot online, and it'll tell you when they receive it in the auditor's office, and it'll tell you when it was counted as well, I think. So that's kind of a neat thing. It was also done during the, when you request your absentee ballot, you could track your absentee ballot request, which is what we did a couple of days later and found out that it was there. We need to vote early, don't we?
Yeah.
And we want to make sure that our votes are counted. One thing that's cool about Kyle and I is we've disagreed on some candidates, haven't we?
Yeah.
Kyle's usually wins out. It's usually in the primary process, because we are kind of like-minded with some things, huh? But primary process, we have disagreed on candidates. And I like to say that because, Kyle does have an intellectual disability, and some folks might think that it's two votes for me, and it truly is not. We have lots of conversations about the candidates, don't we? To make sure. We've done some volunteer work during the process. And so it's great to be involved if you can, or as much as you can be involved. And I guess just to close it out, we want to tell people to get out and do what?
Vote.
Vote. And vote early if you can again, but by all means, vote safely in however you can. So thank you all very much. Appreciated the opportunity to participate in this great event tonight. And thank you, Jen, for putting everything together.
On to Eric.
Ready?
And let's give a moment to switch interpreters. All right.
Ready?
Yes.
Okay, I'm Eric, and I go by he, him, and his pronouns. And today I'm going to be talking about what would you do if you were going to vote at the polls and you decided not to vote absentee, you were voting at the polls. So if you vote on election day at the polls, remember that election day is November 3rd from 7 a.m. to 9 p.m. So this is what happens when you vote at the polls in person. You will come to your polling site. You will arrive. You will be greeted by the poll worker, who will be sitting at a sign-in table at the entrance. You will be asked to show your ID and your voter registration card. Parentheses, if needed, you have the option to register to vote on election day at your polling location. You may be asked to vote using a provisional ballot if you need to register to vote on election day. And then you would need to return it at a later point with the proper forms of voter ID or a testament or someone to vote for you. When you vote, you will be asked to, or when you are at the polling table with the poll worker, you will be asked to verify your address / your contact information and sign your name on the voting roll. You will be given a ballot. You will mark your ballot in a voting booth. And when you are completed, you will insert your ballot into the ballot counting machine. That completes the process of voting. After that, you will depart or leave your voting location and go about your day. But I do have a couple other points. You can ask for assistance. Two officials, one from each political party, will assist you together, monitoring that assistance that you receive is fair and nonpartisan and unbiased. Use of an electronic voting machine. This machine is what Kyle and Bill described, and it tabulates and records your votes similarly to using an ATM, and has audio options to assist those who are visually impaired. Or another option you have is curbside voting. You can vote from your vehicle upon arrival at your polling location. Upon arrival, request assistance by calling ahead or calling when you get there, or you can walk in and say, I'm here and I need assistance. Two officials, again, one from each political party, will bring out your ballot to your vehicle, monitoring that the assistance that you receive is, again, fair, nonpartisan, and unbiased, and wait for you to vote your ballot and return your voted ballot to the poll workers at your polling site. And let's see. Jen, did you want me to talk about the specifics about what would you do if you're voting absentee or voting early, like what you actually physically do?
The voting early is great.
Okay. You have the option of voting early. You can vote early by voting an absentee ballot in person at the auditor's office or elections office beginning today. Today was the first day of early voting in Iowa. And you can vote early also at satellite voting locations in your area. Availability and hours of early voting depends on your area and location and your county. So please call your county auditor and check your voting times, because it may be different for each county. There are 99 counties in the state. Thank you.
Wealth of knowledge. Thank you, Eric.
I apologize to the interpreter. I got rushed there right at the beginning, and then I remembered to slow down. Sorry about that.
All right, let's give a moment. Beautiful. You guys are awesome. Holly or Lisa is back, and we're going to let Garrett take it over.
Hi. I'm excited to be here tonight for many reasons, but most of all to be a community advocate as well as a disability advocate. And tonight I'm going to just briefly share with you a little bit about voting rights for individuals with disabilities and knowing your rights in particular. To follow up with Eric, as he mentioned a lot of good things, today was the first day that people can get out to vote. But in addition to that, your rights are to register to vote, you must be at least 17 years old or a person that will turn 18 on or before election day. In the case of a primary election, a person may vote if they will be 18 years old on or before the corresponding regular election. Voters who are 18 years old and registered to vote in Iowa have the right to vote in Iowa elections. Voters will be asked to simply show an ID before voting. A voter without one of the approved forms of ID may have the voter's identity attested to or by another registered voter in the precinct, or may prove identity and the resident using election day registration documents. Voters have the right to vote a provisional ballot if their eligibility to vote is questioned. Voters who go to the wrong voters who go to the wrong precinct to vote must be given their correct precinct location by precinct poll members. In addition to that, voters have the right to vote by themselves or with help. Voters may choose who helped them, but it cannot be an employee of theirs or an official of their union. Voters with a conservator or guardian may have the right to vote unless a judge specifically said in a court ruling they may not. Voters have the right to vote the way they choose. Voters have the right to get help by calling one of the numbers that we can share with you. We will have it in a link, so we'll share that for you. Voters also have the right to be shown how to make their choices on the ballot. Also, voters waiting in line when the polling site closes must be allowed to vote. Voters have the right to vote curbside at polling locations, to precinct election officials, one from each political party, in partisan elections, will bring out voting materials to you in your car, and you can mark them your ballot in your car, which for me, I believe it's great. It helps with accessibility, and it also helps that person feel as though they can participate just like anyone else can. This election to me is really important because of disability rights right now and healthcare rights. And I encourage you all just to simply talk to friends, talk to family, talk to whoever you might choose. And I thank you so much for listening and coming. And I hope you all enjoy the rest of our meeting. Thank you.
Thanks, Garrett. There are so many rights, and I think in an earlier conversation with Rima that we had in July, we have one of the best states for disability voting rights, and we need to take advantage of it. All right, short break, and we transition, and it's all yours, Cindy.
Hi again. I was a former caregiver. I worked direct care for 31 years, caring for many disabled and elderly over that time period. And my input in this little meeting tonight is to encourage all family, friends, and caregivers to vote as well, because that's supporting the people that you care for. And it's important that we all go out and vote and give our voice so that the changes that need to be done for the disability community are done. So my little spiel is pretty short. Get out and vote.
Very, very important piece, though. The Brink app. It is something that I will, again, will share in the comments below. It is an app that was created for people with disabilities by people with disabilities to make sure that we have access and kind of a checklist to follow for voting. And I've checked it out. Tucker said earlier today that Google Play, it's not available through them yet, but it is working through on iPhones. It has you enter your address into it, and it will bring up Iowa general election November 3rd. And then it has a wonderful checklist to go through all those steps we talked about already. Check voter registration, and it has a link to take you to that site to check. If you haven't, it has the link to register you to vote right there. And you can check those things off that you've done them. Then goes down to apply for your absentee ballot if you haven't already. And in the comments on the Facebook Live, we did put, there's an absentee ballot tracker. So you can track where that is, because a lot of people have requested those ballots quite a while ago already. And now they're just sending them out. So you can kind of track where it's at. And you can check that off. And then there's another section called Prepare. And it has links to every candidate that's running for office at the federal level, at the state level, at the county level, at the local level, and at the judicial level. And it has the links to the websites and to social media for each of those candidates. In addition, it has a way for you to indicate which is your favorite, so it helps you remember who you want to vote for. And it also indicates that absentee ballots really should be sent in around October 24th, just to make sure that they get in on time. They have to be postmarked by November 2nd to count. And we know with the fear of the mail kind of being wonky right now, I'm so glad that everybody mentioned the early voting option, the drop-off boxes. And again, just call your auditor's office and ask which way you want and what times and places, those details. And also if it has help on there. So if you have questions on anything and how to use the app, it's just a wonderful thing. And it's, again, I'll put the link in the comments because it's a really useful tool. And we really want to promote things that are coming from within the disability community here. Another option, if you don't want to use or have another app on your phone, is Ballotpedia. You can look up all the candidates they're running for office and kind of get the cut and dry what they stand for, rather than, because there's so much rhetoric going on in the commercials and things that it's easy to go, well, all that, I just don't want to deal with all of that, so I'm not even going to vote. We don't want you to think that way. We want you to get information on the candidates and vote according to which candidate most aligns with what you believe in. A lot of the commercials aren't even paid for by the campaigns. They're by the political action groups that are paying for the helping pay for the campaign. So it's the messaging can get off. The last thing I want to mention is the Empower app, which is a friend-to-friend texting relational organizing that we are starting to use within our group. If you want to help get out the vote with your friends and family, I will again put that link in the comments, and feel free to contact us if you have any questions. It's fairly easy to use once you've gotten used to it. You kind of have to play with it, but we rushed through this. I can't believe that we're like almost done already. But I think it gives us an opportunity, yes, to talk about some of the stories, some of the personal barriers that you all have had in the past and what you've done about it, because you guys are an awesome group of advocates. And can help somebody who maybe might be nervous about voting or has never voted before. If they have a barrier, they might be able to address it better. Mm-hmm. Garrett's hand is raised. We're gonna let him go.
Okay, thank you, Jen. I just wanted to start off. I thank Jen for so much. She is our main woman, our go-to girl, that she is wonderful in so many different ways. But I kind of wanted to personally share with you all a little bit of my background just with voting, and to share just my experience. Each one of us kind of has a different little story, but a lot of it is similar also. So for me, I'm a quadriplegic, paralyzed from the neck down. I was paralyzed at the age of 4 in a motorcycle accident. I went to high school, graduated, furthered on my education, and I wrote my first book, which was an autobiography. And then after that, I really came into myself, found what I'm passionate about, and it's just sharing my story with others. But going with voting, I want to say that I have voted in person before, which I found it very nice, very comfortable going in. I've always had my mom or someone go with me, which helps me write down and check, mark whoever I would like to choose. And I've also done absentee ballot over the years. And I just believe that we do have options, but right now we need to do what's safe and what's appropriate during this time of COVID. And for individuals with disabilities, it's important that we have that access and do get out our absentee ballots and, you know, talk to our friends and just let them know what you're planning on doing and trying to simply encourage and help one another out. So thank you.
Kyle and Bill, you're up.
Real quick, something that we kind of thought about as after our discussion was, I want to encourage people, sometimes when you do get your absentee ballot, there are specific instructions with that. And I just want to make sure that people read those carefully or have somebody read those to you if that is the case. And if there's still some confusion, again, call your auditor's office because they're the folks, or the Secretary of State's office, because they can help you with that as well. Because I know there's a couple envelopes and there's an outer envelope that needs to be signed, and sometimes folks forget to do that. So just look that over carefully when you get that. And if you have any questions, make sure you take that to proper folks. That's it. Thank you.
So, Jen.
It's all yours.
So this is Eric again, and I just wanted to add that people need to remember to vote both sides of your ballot. So there's two sides. So please don't just vote for the presidential and all the sexy contests on the front side. Please turn it over and also vote for the county and the local races and also the judicial retention races, and vote for how you would want that to go. But don't forget to vote both sides of your ballot. And also, if you have any questions about any of the candidates, another place to go is your local League of Women Voters. They're also a good resource and they are bipartisan. So.
While we have you on, because you're Mr. Everywhere and have such good knowledge, Catherine Gertz, Kathy Hafsey asked, do you need both the ID card and voter registration card?
I carry them both. I think you absolutely need your ID at least, but I would bring both because you don't want to not have one and then not be able to vote. So go ahead and bring both and be safe rather than sorry.
We have a couple hands up, so I'm not sure who goes next. I'm going to have Cindy go.
Yeah, I believe with all the things that's gone on in the past year, as far as IDs and stuff, it is the ID and it has to be a current one. Mm-hmm. That's all you have to worry about. And I don't know. I think there's something else in there, Eric. Maybe you can answer this for me.
Is that the dog in the background, Cindy?
Yes, sorry.
Okay. So say your statement again.
Okay. If you've changed addresses and you're trying to locate your polling station or make sure you're at the right one, do you need to bring some proof of that change of address?
I'm not sure off the top of my head. I would bring a utility bill or a cable bill with me, or I would also pre-register. So pre-register again with your new address before October 24th. And if you're registered under your new address, when you show up on election day, you should be fine. But absolutely, I would bring some kind of a utility bill or some other kind of second ID that would have the new address with me. But to directly answer your question, I'm not sure. I'd have to look it up and get back to you.
And where is, like, if somebody wanted to look up that information, is it best to look at the Secretary of State or to call the auditor's office, or either?
You can do either. And another place to look that stuff up is infonet.iowa.org is the Infonet newsletter that the Iowa DD Council puts out for their political advocacy for people with disabilities. And they have a page on their website talking all about voting basics for people with disabilities. That's where I got my information from. And so that's a good place for people to go to. Infonetiowa.org is the website there.
Garrett, do you have anything to add?
No, I believe Eric did pretty well explaining with your voters when you go in to your, if you're going into your voting place. I know that I always carry my card with me along with my ID. Mm-hmm. So I know that I am sure that I can vote. But with the change of address, yes, I know that you have to show some form of identification for updating your current address. And then for submitting it, you have different options. Always check with your county auditor, Secretary of State. And then there are going to be at your polling stations, there are drop boxes, and you can always call and contact whomever you need to if you would like as well. So yeah, but Eric wrapped it up fairly well.
Awesome. A couple last things is, if you are dealing with any type of barrier that keeps you, that you think might keep you from voting, let your auditor's office know, let disability rights know, let us know to see if there's any way that we can figure out how to help you. That's part of what we like to do, is do the outreach and get to know other folks in the disability community and their family and friends and caregivers. We've been growing over the last 2 years, and it's because our members are our leaders. And it's wonderful. There's two more events coming up. Our next one is October 19th. We'll also be on Facebook Live like this. We're calling it #WhyWeVote. And we are looking for people who want to share short videos with us. We have a short script, just kind of your name, what city you live in, and why you're voting this year, or why you think voting is important. You can through like Facebook or email it, or we also have an app within our group that we're trying out. If you want to, you know, really try something funky. And we're happy to, we'll be posting all those, all that information on our page in the upcoming 2 weeks. We hope you join us again. It's going to be a, really a celebration of the disability vote and the importance of why we need to show our vote this year more than we ever have. Kind of to be taken more seriously is part of it, what it feels like. But the third one, which I think is the most fun, is Crip the Vote has been a hashtag that's been used, that they're doing a lot of chats in Twitter with elected officials and trying to, you know, make sure we're getting out the disability vote along with Rev Up and AAPD. They're doing fabulous, fabulous work. We're going to call ours hashtag Creep the Vote because it's on Halloween. And we want to have some fun. We want to, you know, people to be in costume, and we can, if they want to drop off their ballot or vote in costume and take a picture, we would love to share it because, you know, it shouldn't feel like a job. Voting is a right. It's something to celebrate. And this year it's, we need something to celebrate, I think, all around. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna look real quick if there's any other questions. Do you guys have any other final thoughts?
Just get out and vote. It's a very important election, and I wanna touch on why we vote for a second. Your vote is your voice. And that's what I wanted to also say on October 19th, and we'll get into that when we get there to our next event that Jen was talking about. But one of the reasons why we vote is our vote is our voice, and there have been so many times in the lives of people with disabilities where your voice has not been listened to, and where people with disabilities are voting, our voices can be heard on an equal basis with those without disabilities. So don't pass up the chance to use your voice and have this way of saying, I'm here too, I count too. So don't you pass that up, make yourself count. Your voice is your vote. Your vote is your voice, sorry.
Cindy, did you have something?
I'm just agreeing with what Eric's saying. So yes, get out and vote, or vote from home, wherever you choose to do so. Just vote.
I don't think any of us could have said it any better. So we're gonna head off a little bit early because we actually got through everything, which is wonderful. And we had some extra time just to story tell a bit. So thank you everybody for joining us. Thank you, Holly and Lisa, for interpreting and lobbying, just making this seamless. We will be captioning this and putting it on YouTube. Feel free to share it. We did try to have it captioned for tonight and that didn't work. We apologize. But working on trying to make things more accessible is a very high priority for us. So, all right, are you guys ready? We're gonna try to do this. 1, 2, 3. Why are we doing this? To get out the disability vote. Maybe we need to do it. That is what democracy looks like, right there.
Yes.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a good night. And get out the vote.
Thank you. Get out the vote.